Hi, this is Kat Gavin. Welcome to Breaking Bread, bite-sized messages to feed your inner man. Over the next several weeks and months, I plan to share with you my insights on the Book of Revelation as I study it. So this bread will be hot out of the oven. Today, we're going to continue in Revelation chapter 3, but this time focus on the church in Philadelphia. So I begin reading from verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem. I will write upon him my new name. So in Exodus, the Israelites struck the blood of a lamb upon the doorposts and lintels of their houses to keep those within it safe from the destroyer. In Genesis, pitch was generously applied to Noah's ark to keep those within it safe from the great flood. The cross upon which Jesus shed his blood represents both those doorposts and Noah's ark. Within the door is found spiritual safety. But what does it take to enter the door? What is required? If we look in the book of Leviticus, we find that animals were sacrificed and lepers were cleansed at or by the door of the tabernacle. I read that in Leviticus 14. This shall be the law of the leper in the day of his cleansing. On the seventh day, he shall wash his clothes. Also, he shall wash his flesh in water, and he shall be clean. And the priest that maketh him clean shall present the man at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. So we have to be crucified with Christ and washed by the water of the word before we can enter the door into his kingdom of righteousness. In Genesis 19 and Judges 19, the unclean beat at the door, but were not able to enter. They sought the door, but were not able to find it. And there came two angels to Sodom at even, and Lot said, Behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house. And they said, Nay, but we will abide in the streets all night. And he pressed upon them greatly, and they turned in unto him and entered into his house. But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house around. And they pressed sore upon the man, even Lot, and came near to break the door. But the men put forth their hand and pulled Lot into the house of them, and shut to the door. And they smote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they wearied themselves to find the door. The saints of Philadelphia had kept the word. They had not denied God's name. Therefore, an open door was set before them. And this is similar to the last chapter in Revelation, Revelation 22, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Those that do his commandments may enter the city. At the same time, they are the city, the temple in which God dwells. In Revelation 3:12, the saints at Philadelphia were told, Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God. Let's consider how the tabernacle of Moses was constructed. We'll turn to Exodus 26. And thou shalt make an hanging for the door of the tent of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen wrought with needlework. And thou shalt make for the hanging five pillars of shittim wood and overlay them with gold. The door of the tent was a curtain made of fine linen, hung from five golden pillars. When Jesus died on the cross, the veil to the holiest was rent. The veil represented his flesh. In the Gospel of John, Jesus said, "I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life." When Jesus said to the saints at Philadelphia, "Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God," he meant not only would they be granted access to the door, but they would be part of the door, since the door was hung from pillars. Let me read you something in Deuteronomy 15. "And if thy brother, an Hebrew man or an Hebrew woman, be sold unto thee and serve thee 6 years, then in the seventh year thou shalt let him go free from thee. If he say unto thee, I will not go away from thee, because he loveth thee and thine house, then thou shalt take an awl and thrust it through his ear unto the door, and he shall be thy servant forever." Just as Jesus was nailed to the cross, those who commit to being his servant forever are nailed to the door. They become one with the door. In Revelation 3:12, it says, "I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem. I will write upon him my new name." So just as blood was struck upon the doorposts and pitch was generously applied to Noah's Ark, God's name, representing his character, his spirit, marks those who belong to him. The spirit of life in Christ Jesus is God's seal, his signature, his mark of ownership upon his people. As God's faithful servants, forever nailed to the door, we usher souls into his kingdom. Just as Noah, a preacher of righteousness, ushered every creature onto the ark, just as Lot pleaded with two angels to enter the safety of his house and not sleep on the streets of Sodom. Yet God alone opens and shuts the door. God alone opens and shuts our eyes so we may or may not find the door. Revelation 3:7 says, "He that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth." God shut the door of the ark. God smote the Sodomites with blindness. God is not to be trifled with, ignored, or pushed into a corner. "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near." If you respond to God's grace, the divine influence upon the heart, by crucifying your flesh with the affections and lusts, by cleansing yourself with the washing of water by the word, God will set before you an open door to his kingdom of righteousness. In my next video, we will look at the church in Laodicea. If you want to follow along this journey with me, click the subscribe button. I'd love to read your insights in the comment section below. Also, in the description box, you'll find my contact details and information regarding our Zoom fellowship. Until my next video, God bless.